Welcome to Second Take, the show that focuses on the issues behind the news. Anglo Platinum, AngloGold Ashanti, and Kumba Iron-Ore made headlines this week. Mining Weekly editor Martin Creamer unpacks them. Welcome, Martin.
Hi, Session.
Now, Amplats is taking steps to reverse what it calls unjustified investor bearishness.
You know, it's terrible that we're selling our platinum at a loss. So the poor South is subsidizing the rich North. Mm. And we often look at the way they arrive at that price and we say, let's have more transparency here. But what is really annoying at the moment is the overemphasis of the dependence of our platinum on West European diesel demand. That is being blown out of all proportion to a point where it knocked our price down by $60 a couple of weeks ago. And what we're saying is that that's fiction. And it's time to turn that excessive bearishness around, because it's not true. You know, you can see that diesel grew by 1%, according to the reports coming out of all the companies at the moment. So it's not as if it's in a downward plunge. Where it comes to light-duty cars, where it comes to the light-duty side, yes, you know, there has been a decline. But outside of Europe, that car demand in diesel has actually risen. And when you look at heavy-duty demand, it is rising, it's growing. When you look at industrial demand, it's strong. I mean, everybody wants a flat-screen TV these days. You know, platinum has to be used to produce that flat glass, that specialty glass. There are so many other activities that are showing that there is a demand for platinum at industrial level. So this needs to be turned around. And it was pleasing that, you know, Anglo-American Platinum, in response to Mining Weekly this week, said yes, they believe it should be turned around as well, because this is not actually reflecting the accurate position, and that they would take some steps to try and inform the market of the realities.
Mm. And AngloGold Ashanti is getting a new CEO.
You know, this is incredible. We've had fantastic CEOs at AngloGold Ashanti. You know, it began in 1998 with Bobby Godsell. I mean, there was no better CEO. This guy was really tops. He was so articulate in everything he said that journalists could just absorb it and understand it. And so he was the first mining company to take his company onto the New York Stock Exchange, but it was as a secondary listing. So he didn't make it a primary listing. He kept the Johannesburg Stock Exchange as the primary listing, which was the correct thing to do. And he took lions, African lions, onto the New York stage there. And then he supported even our lions in the Joburg Zoo here, because it was about this lion that was going to move forward. And we saw how well it did. And his main target was the people. You know, having come out of human resources, he wanted to develop the people. And I can remember sitting there at that inauguration dinner, and there were so many workers there. You know, you don't normally go to a dinner and find mine workers sitting there. It was such a good symbol. And we also ate out of the utensils that they use in mining hostels. So we were using the utensils, even with all these celebrities. So that sent a message. He was then, you know, replaced by Mark Kudufani. Brilliant, absolutely brilliant CEO. And of course, he was then headhunted by Anglo-American, where he's now active. And then taking over was Srinivasan Venkat Krishnan. I still have to look at that. He was good enough to allow us to call him Venkat. He was remarkable. I mean, his tenure was governed by strong decision making, and you know, he was like a servant leader. You know, he made sure that he wouldn't take excessive bonuses. He used his excess money to help students. He was really very, very focused on the success of the business and how it could be improved. And so we've had tremendous leadership from him. He now hands over the reins to another top figure now coming in, and we'll have to learn to pronounce his name as well, but it's Kelvin Dashniski. So we're gonna have to get used to that. But he's from Barrick. He's the president of Barrick. And you know, this is sending a symbol to me that they only take really blue chip leaders to run this company. And if they do that, surely it must be in the best hands. But what worries me is the statements coming out of it that, you know, the demise of the gold industry is inevitable. We see Moab went into the hands of Harmony. Are we looking at a handover process here, you know, at the South African level? Because of course we were invited to do a lot with Sunrise Dam this week, which is in Australia. So are they looking outside the country? One hopes not. One hopes that this leader will do something more in the country, because there's gold to get. There's 1.3 billion ounces of gold still in the ground in South Africa, in the Witwaters Rand, which is more gold than we've mined since 1886. So if we don't change our mining method, all we're going to get is like 200 million ounces. Mm. So what is the great need? The great need out there is to meet this challenge of being able to mine differently, because there's wealth in that ground. Mm. Huge wealth, even at these prices. It was admirable that, you know, under Mark Kudafani and under Venkat, they went hammer and tongs for this raise boring method. But you can see they're backing off that. It's none of the great laudatory comment that we had at the start. So what is the solution now to get that gold out of the ground? I mean, we're hearing these reports that, okay, it's over for us. But is it, if there's so much gold in the ground? So who is going to come forward with a solution? We had this sort of crisis in the past in history, you know, where they said it's all over for South Africa's gold mining. And then someone came out with a way of treating the gold using cyanide. And that was the breakthrough, and everything started moving very, very fast again. We're looking for another catalyst to make sure we can get that wealth out of the ground. But in the meantime, we are having to listen to comments that the demise of the gold industry is inevitable. And we see that I think even Mexico is producing more gold than we're doing at the moment.
And lastly, Kumba Iron-Ore is receiving strong premiums for high-grade ore.
Yeah, I was so happy to be a South African at that presentation, because, wow, we've really got high-quality iron ore. And you can see that the world wants high-quality iron ore, because it's related to climate change. It's related to the reality of not putting too much pollution into the air. And here we've got this high-grade, low-alumina product, and we've got a lumpy ore. And you can see the world is prepared to pay more for that because of the situation in our whole globe around climate change and around productivity and around doing things better. You can see the Chinese changing a lot of the ways they do things and then being prepared to pay more. They're talking about the Chinese will just now be on a par when it comes to producing steel and using iron ore as Europe and Japan. They're reaching that level. They're closing all the high pollution steel mills and the sintering, and they're going in for this higher grade product, and they prepared to pay for it. But who can supply it? South Africa. But what broke my heart was that we lost a 2 billion rand plus opportunity because our state owned Transnet had 6 derailments on that line. No, really. I mean, I think we need to be informed of this quicker, because I certainly didn't realize this until last week. When the first derailment takes place, it should be headline, because this means we are losing our foreign exchange opportunity. Mm. Instead of that iron ore going out there in South Africa earning foreign exchange, which it desperately needs at the moment, it's not going out because of a state entity and the derailment of the logistics down the line. I mean, that is bad that they could tolerate 6 derailments, 4 in iron ore and 2 in manganese. Now, there's such a thing as take or pay. Now, we find that if the miners are not ready with their product, they've still got to pay. Because the state-owned intel, you say, we got our trains there, you weren't there, sorry guys, give us the money. Now what if they don't take, as they haven't been doing because they've had the derailments? Yeah. We need to know what penalty they're paying, because it's quite sort of behind the scenes what goes on there, because they are hurting the South African economy, and this is a state-owned entity which should know better, and they should be informing everybody about that situation. But in the meantime, you know, thank goodness for our high quality iron ore, and you can see that they're playing catch up now because the price is going. So the second half of this year should see some very good results for Kumba iron ore. On the price of iron ore at the moment, it hasn't been hit by Donald Trump. I mean, you know, this is pretty bad that you have a first world country like America putting out messages that are knocking metal prices down, you know, seeing them knock the nickel price down, copper price down. Thank goodness, well, it hasn't hit Kumba yet on the iron ore, but it could hurt us going forward if Donald Trump decides to slap all these tariffs on China and start upsetting the world equilibrium. That could hurt us. So we hope that we'll be able to escape that. But it doesn't look like it at the moment. And certain metals are already being badly affected.
Thanks for speaking with us, Mark.
It's a great pleasure, Sashni.
That's it for today. Join us again next week for more news analysis on South Africa's mining industry.